Good morning and a happy Sabbath to you, and welcome to the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are so happy that you could join with us on this cold December morning. I just want to mention a few names I see that are joining us. We have Stacey Ann, Meheret, Sunny Jack, Kareen, Barbara, and Joseph. Thank you to you and all of you who are joining us this morning. I would like to read a verse that I find that is very uplifting from the Bible. Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." This one verse that I find very encouraging tells us that Jesus can sympathize with our weaknesses. Several other versions use the words empathize to reinforce the fact that Jesus literally feels and knows what we go through because he has gone through it himself. On the same note, Jesus was in all points tempted as we are. The same temptations we face in our day-to-day lives were also faced at a greater degree by Jesus. He went through what we go through, but by relying on prayer and his relationship with his heavenly Father, he was able to remain sinless, enabling him to save us all. As Pastor John often reminds us, God is not a distant deity, but a present reality. He is able to understand what we go through and is willing to help us in our lives. I pray that you would meditate on these thoughts, not only today, but throughout this coming week as we go through life's trials and temptations. I would like to remind you that we at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church are so blessed by all of you who join with us week after week to worship our God. We need your prayers and support, and we thank God for those of you who are already doing so. I ask that you would support the various ministries of this church, both through prayer and contribution. Specifically, I ask that you would support the media ministry. We urgently need your financial contributions if these broadcasts are to continue. The media ministry relies on your financial support. You are the reason that we are here. Please pray for us so we could continue to bring more messages like this to people like you. Additionally, I would like to remind you that the prayer and praise service that we have in the afternoon will be held at 4 o'clock, that's 4 p.m. today. Please join via YouTube, Facebook, and Zoom, and send in your requests. And as always, we love to hear from you. You can visit our website, remnantsdachurch.org, to request for prayers and contact us. Don't forget to leave your name and the place you are reaching out to us from. Today's message is titled, An Amazing Grace Christmas, and is brought to us by our very own Pastor Sujjan John. We also pray you will be blessed by the various musical talents that will be shared to praise God today and remind you of Jesus' birth and life. We pray we are a blessing to you, and once again, welcome to the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Good morning and a happy Sabbath to all of you who are worshiping with us on our live broadcast on this beautiful Sabbath morning. Welcome to our praise session, which we will begin with the use of hymn number 124, which is Away in a Manger. If you have your hymnals at home, you can turn to 124.
Jesus, made down its decay.
you turn to 136, good Christians now rejoice. There may be some who are not familiar with this, but this is a very old Christmas carol, and let's try to sing it together. Good Christians now rejoice. Good Christians now rejoice. Born to save, indeed. That's the reason he was sent to this earth. He is the reason for the season. Keeping that in mind, let's turn to 187. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. If you give me an E, or a chord E, we'll sing it. You don't know it? No, okay. All right. Our musicians don't seem to know that. Let us sing 122, another carol. 122. Take a little lower key.
Thank you.
Let's turn to Christ's birth without singing about the reason that he came, that he was born. He was born to die on the cross for our sins. Yeah. And it doesn't end there because he rose again, didn't he not? And he is going to come again. Let us turn to 426. I shall see the King.
I'm
516. 516, we'll sing the first and last verses of 516. All the way. Sing the first verse only of 213. 213. Just one verse of 213. As you continue to worship in peace and quiet.
Well, we're in the Christmas season, so I wanted to talk to you a little bit about Christmas from a health standpoint. Did you know that Christmas is considered one of the top six stressors in a person's life? Not for the year, but in the entire life. And it comes once a year. Well, it'd be pretty important to know how to deal with it, wouldn't it? I went to look at what are the things that are stressing people out, and I have to be honest, I don't experience even the tiniest bit of stress on Christmas, and I'll show you why and why that can be your experience too. But considering it is one of the top six stressors, and in those six stressors are divorce, death of someone, making a major move, and so on, and there comes this once-in-a-year thing of Christmas. Well, one of the top things that causing stress in Christmas is finances. Now, why would that cause more stress in Christmas than any other time of the year? Because people are trying to do an outlay more than what they can afford. They're buying presents for, usually it's presents for people that really don't need it. And they're spending out, sometimes it's because of vanity, why they want to show more than somebody else, or it may just be something of need, or because this is what society tells me I must do, and they're out for this great expense. One of the other major stressors, and this was, I think, number two, was not having enough time for yourself. You were out there and doing so much, and time management, of course, comes in there. I believe it was Martin Luther that made the statement one time that, I'm so busy today, I'm going to have to spend at least 4 hours in prayer. You think, well, that doesn't make sense. Well, it actually does make sense. See, if you don't know how to manage your time, you'll find yourself with not enough time to do. But there's something, whether you're rich or poor, we all have the same amount of it, and that's time. You don't have any more than anybody else, and you don't have any less. So how to organize your day in a sense that you're not stressed out because you don't have enough time? Well, don't put upon yourself more than what you can do. You have your time for sleep, and don't touch that time. That's the time that always people are like, well, I guess I won't sleep as much. No, don't touch that time. If you touch that time, you're going to get sick. And then you'll have a lot of time on your hands that you don't want to have. Don't touch that time. Consider it almost as sacred time. You need time for the Lord. You wake up and you have to spend time with the Lord. Don't touch that time at all. It's like the tithe money. You don't touch that. That belongs to the Lord. And there are certain things you have to eat. So, well, I don't have time to eat. I'm just going to eat really quick. You know, we're told that if you don't have enough time to eat, eat less. So, well, that doesn't make sense. And she says, eat slower. But I don't have the time. Eat less, eat slower, chew the food more thoroughly, and we're told we get more benefit than out of just shoveling it down. You know that where the good taste comes from, it's not from the amount of food, but it's having it on your tongue. Just take a glass of juice and drink it, and just go, 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 go. And when you stop, that's when you taste it. If you just take a sip, you can enjoy the flavor. Well, along with that comes with another stressor, is people are stressed out about the preparations for Christmas, making this great big meal. You don't need 20 dishes. In fact, your stomach doesn't want it. Your stomach, there's war inside the stomach when you have so many different combinations. Simplify your life. And another great stressor was overweight. Ah, it's Christmas time and I know I'm going to gain so much weight. Well, why? I mean, we are not slaves, we're masters of ourselves. You don't have to eat everything that's there. You can just say no. You say, no, I'm going to eat. This is what's good for me, and this is all I'm going to eat. Another big stressor was decorating the house. Well, I'm not about to tell anyone how to decorate their house, but I will give a simple principle, and it goes along with time management. Don't put upon yourself more than what you can do. Don't feel like you have to do these things because this is what society is telling us. This is what my parents or my in-laws or whatever it may be. The only thing you should be at all concerned about, of other people think about, is your spouse. And if your spouse is putting upon you more than you can do, just sit down and talk to them and say, listen, honey, I have only so much I can do. And I'll do what I can extra, but I think we need to simplify things. So let this Christmas be a time of what it's supposed to be. You know, above all people, we've been privileged with a balancing light that we've been given to know what to do. I encourage all of you, read that chapter on Christmas and Adventist Home, because it helps us. On one side, we know that we don't know when Jesus was born, and that is for a reason. So we don't give honor to the day instead of honor to the Creator. But on the other side, we're told not to ignore the day. It's a day that we should lead people to God, let them know about God. And let your Christmas be as such. If you have children, use it as a time not to lavish of all these indulgent gifts, but to lead their mind to God. Use it as a day to talk about Jesus and give gifts that are going to help them in that walk. And in just doing that alone, it takes all the stress out of Christmas. Thank you.
Just the thought of making people know that we had ordered oranges this month, and we already got rid of every one of them. Some of you ordered but did not pick up them. And we had to give it to the other people who came and asked for it, and we had to give it. Sorry about that. And we'll be ordering again the coming month. Please send in your orders by text message so that we will know that you have what you need. We are bringing our navel oranges, ruby red grapefruits, and we can also the gift boxes that we can get them. So please kindly send in your orders as soon as possible so that we can get the orders in. Also, we need to have 150 boxes for them to deliver it into the facility. If we do not have that, then we have to pay extra for the delivering. So please note this, and please pass the word around to your neighbors, friends, so that they also can be benefited out of this. What oranges are good for your cold season, which is now especially also for the COVID-19 that you are facing through. This helps the immune system of your body to remove the toxic, the waste toxic out of your body, and helps for the infection of the lungs. So please try to tell your friends so that we can get enough orders so that we can make people happy and healthy also. And those you have picked up, please make sure that you send in your check to the church office on, so that we can settle the accounts for them also. And so please, I urge each one of you members who are listening and the well-wishers, please send in your orders as soon as possible to this car for the building fund. Thanks.
Happy Sabbath, Church. I bring you greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is the very reason for our season this time, this year. Change is a difficult thing. If you want to change, you break your head, plan so much, and even after you have moved, it is such a difficult thing to settle down. But because Jesus is a friend of sinners, he pitched his tent here right on this earth. He made this big move. Why? Because he loves us. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Although we were conceived and born in sin, he loved us. He wants to save us. He wants to live with us. That's why he came to this world, set an example, living 30 plus years. Do you want to make him your friend, is the question. Friends, I welcome you for this Sabbath day. Bless the Lord Jesus Christ and enjoy this season, worshiping him and making him king of your life, inviting him to come, sit and reign on the throne of your heart. Happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. Have a blessed Sabbath.
Morning will be hymn number 123. As with gladness, men of old. Hymn number 123. Lord, may we
Offertory and the Garden of Prayer. Just want to remind those that are participating in our program this Sabbath to make sure to let you know that we're going to go through the program unannounced. So be sure to check the bulletin. If you don't have one, it's in the back so that you'll know when your time is up to be ready. And if you're in line, to be at the back with the sound team so they can make sure that they have everything squared away, as we want to be able to go through this in an orderly fashion in order that we may praise our Lord during this time as you remember his birth. I remind those of you as you prepare your hearts for your offerings at the end of this year, I want to remind you that if you are planning to give for your tax purposes, we want to remind you that those checks and payments, contributions, either online or via check, need to be marked for December 31st, 2020. We need to make sure you remember that. And we thank you all for many of your contributions, those of you, our members, and those that are around the world that have contributed to allowing our ministry to flourish here, well, I should say God's ministry to flourish here in this area, and to reach people that we never thought we'd be able to reach. And that's because of your generous contributions and your sacrifices that you've made in order that we may be able to spread the gospel to the entire world, because we believe here at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church that Jesus is coming soon. So as you think about your time of giving at the end of the year, we pray that you'll keep Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church in your prayers and also in your financial contributions to allow us to meet the needs of this church, that we can continue to spread the gospel of the good news of Jesus Christ. We thank you once again for your ministry to us through your financial contributions and your prayers. As always, you can either mail a check to the church. That address can be found on the church website, or you can give online by clicking on the Giving tab on our church website as well. Thank you, thank you, thank you for all that you've done throughout this year of 2020. We have truly been blessed, and we want to ask for your continued support as we continue to preach the gospel. As we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning, I'll be reading the names of those that have requested prayer, and they are Mehareth, Ethiopia, Samson Fosgay, Robin and Parveen Peter, Maxwell Paul and family, Babu Benjamin, Dr. and Mrs. C.P. Matthew, Shirley Harrison family, Sudha Pillay, Annie Rainey, Liz Arulthas, Pratap and Isaac, Mr. and Mrs. Arulthas, Emil John, J.S. Paul, Janet Smith, Esther Singh and family, Brian and family, Ruthie, Mrs. Lakshma Beckham, Jayan Subhadra, Shashi Masi, Vimal and Binti Mathai, John Gorday and family, Esther and Sheila Gorday, Jenny, Samson and Brandon, Murthy, the country of Armenia, Maya Foster, Nirmala Shavan, Joel Selvaraja, Ponzi's family, Mwansa, Pastor Henry Fordham, Sabina Gunta, Annie Matthew, Mr. Rasanayagam, Stacy Ann Martin's family and business, Priya Anand, Robert's family, Tanya and Linda, Edwin Joseph, Ellen Cromwell, Jayanthi Eshwar Rao, the Gill family, Saul Florence,
Sunny Jack and family, Antonia and Indra, Karen Roberts and family, Sydney, Lizzie Thomas, T.S. Abraham, Dilip and Usha Simpson, Bobby and Joy Kurian, Ram Naidu, Isaac Siobhan, Rita, Nita and Aruna, Siobhan and families, Ronnie and Murali, Dina, Amber Batra, John Waidande, Moli Nuthalapati, Sue Benjamin, Yomi, Patricia, Pastor Sujjan John and family, Pastor Reggie's family, Alicia, Mrs. C.K. John, Ms. Mason and family, Christopher Cole, Zabata and family, Rachel Phillip, Sean, Anne Marie, Padmakar and Susuma Karle, Satya Narayana, Jackie, Sampath Kumari, Philomena and Grace, Lovelina, Laban Rao, and also be presenting two sealed requests to the Lord. As we pray, I invite you to wherever you may be, as far as possible, to kneel as we pray. Our most gracious, merciful, wonderful Creator, our Heavenly Father, we come to you once again this morning on your holy Sabbath day, humbled that we get to come into your presence. Wherever we may be around the world, Lord, I pray that your presence may abide in the homes as we worship you on your Sabbath. We thank you, Lord, for being our God, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the sun, moon, and the stars, the fish in the sea, the fowl of the air, and yet the Bible says, Lord, that you are mindful of us, that you visit with us, that you spend time with us, that you care for us. And in the midst of all the beauty that we see around us, we thank you so much that you have placed such value upon our lives, that you would send your one and only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. Especially during this time of the year, Lord, we especially remember when you came here and pitched your tent among us and dwelt among us. You were Emmanuel, God with us. And at this time, Lord, we thank you and we remember the sacrifice that you have made. For you are a high priest that can sympathize with all of our weak points, Lord, with what all that we're going through. For there are many in this congregation, in this world church, Lord, amongst the hearing of my voice that have gone through very difficult times in the year 2020. They've been struggling of all the names, Lord, you've heard, over 100 names that we've read of people that are having either financial difficulty, physical ailment, an illness, going through some sort of difficulty, Lord, which they ask for special prayer, and we present those names to you. And all of those silent requests that were not mentioned, that I was not able to mention, Lord, we present them to you. The God who is the almighty, powerful one, the omniscient, omnipotent one. We know you care for us. And so I present all of these names and all of these people, Lord, at your throne, at the foot of your throne. Bless them. We pray especially for those that are suffering from illnesses, those that are in the hospital right now, Lord, those that have lost loved ones. Be close to them. We know, Lord, that you love us so much because you came on this earth 2,000 years ago and you walked the streets here. That there would be no mistake, that Satan's lies would not fall on our ears, that we would know the honest truth, and that is that you are good and you are just. You are merciful, you are loving. We thank you, Lord, for that. Help us to remember all that you've done for us. Even in the midst of the difficulties, you have sustained us, you have upheld us, and it is only by your righteous right hand that we are here today, breathing and living in this world. Our very breath is a gift from you. Help us to honor you in all that we say, in all that we do, because of what you have given to us. May we be gracious to others as you've been gracious to us. May we be loving to others as you've been loving to us. May we be merciful to others as you have been merciful to us. And as we end off this year, Lord, help us to end it off in a note that will represent your character, one that others will say, yes, although I had a difficult year, it is a year in which I can still rejoice because the Lord has saved me. The Lord has been by my side. Each and every day, Lord, may we be grateful. We thank you for blessing us. We thank you for being with this church and the ministry, Lord. Continue to bless it and multiply all the work that may go on here, that your coming may be hastened. Today especially, Lord, I pray for all those who are participating that will be bringing us closer to your throne. As the music that is sung and played, may we draw close to you. May your angels sing with us as we worship you, as we remember you. Pray especially also for Pastor Sujjan as he presents the word to us. Bless his lips, and may he bring us closer to you and see you more clearly. Forgive us of our sins, Lord. We are not worthy of all that you do for us, but we thank you for being a loving Father. May we live lives that will bring you honor and glory each and every day, wherever we may be. Hear our prayer. Bless us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
For our scripture reading this morning, let's turn our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. May God bless the scripture.
Welcome to an Amazing Grace Christmas this beautiful Sabbath morning. After I finish what I'm doing here right now, you won't see me, you will hear me in between now and then. The program will go unannounced. Our participant worshipers will come up. They each have a program in their hand, and they will come up as they see their names. The fall. I'm reading from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden. And you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves.
Oh, the plan. Matthew 4:16. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned.
Is there your celebrate with the angels on high, who sang announcing his birth. We celebrate that a Savior is born, who brings us peace to the earth.
Tidings of joy. The the nations. Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great
the ultimate sacrifice. Isaiah 53:5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed.
Completely, a new life is mine, and that is why.
The Resurrection, Luke 24, 1-6. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen."
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness, and rose at every sound. Half in hopeless sorrow, and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Then just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the streets, expecting swords and torches and the sounds of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And then John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone, an empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened, but just what I didn't know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, for I'd seen them crucify him, and then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, all the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. Even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the sky. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had
just melted into peace. Sweet peace. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive.
What reason did the Godhead have? Ephesians 2, 4 to 8. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God.
How true it is, the Lord that we worship is alive. I'd like to take this opportunity to join hands with our youth pastor, Reggie Samuel, and also the elders of the Remnant Church to welcome all of you for a divine hour. We are so happy that you are able to join us for this special program of Christmas. I'd like to take this time to thank David Roberts for putting this whole program together, for getting in touch with the singers and having everything in place. And so, David, thank you so much for your ministry here. We are truly blessed. I also would like to thank all the participants for taking time to practice and to come and to praise God, for using your talents for God's glory. May the Lord richly bless you. And I also would like to thank our media ministry here, who behind the scene, they do a lot of work for us. And so we want to thank all the ones who are in the media ministry. Now, we do have a number of visitors, so on behalf of the Remnant Church, along with the youth pastor and the elders, may I welcome you in a very special way. We have Ponzi from Africa, Stacy Ann Martin, Meheret from Ethiopia, Sunny Jack, Barbara Mary from Mountain View, California, Corinne Fender, Dean Knapp, Joseph Sutterly, Sam Beckham, Amber Ingram, Esther Singh, Chiquita, Jennifer Cobbler, Jay Devdas and his dear wife Subhadra from Redding, California, Clifton Coyle Pillay, Sampa Jayaraman, Maurice Madhu from Pune, India, Pradeep Suranjan from Bangalore, Clara McCoy, Robin Peter, Lindsay Rittman, Sony Bhavani, Mercy Salagala, Rani Sirka, Grace Lafarty, Albert Mugita, Kyle Chambers, and Sheila Gode. These are the name that was submitted to me. I'm sure there are many more who have joined us here. We want you to know that we are truly blessed to have you. As I keep saying, that Remnant Church is not the only church that is streaming the services. Almost every church is streaming, and so if you choose to worship with us, it is a deliberate choice that you have made to be part of us. And we want you to know that we are privileged, and you are part of the extended family of the Remnant Church. And we truly appreciate your fellowship,
And it's my prayer that in some small measure, if this church has been a blessing to you, if this ministry has been a blessing to you, so kindly consider very prayerfully of supporting the church, because everything that is done here requires finance. So please do consider. And may the Lord richly bless you as you worship with us today. We do have a few announcements. Let me take this time. And I also would like to thank Sue and Rachel and also Sarika for taking many hours putting together, for setting up this beautiful flower arrangement, not only here, you see them all over here, giving us the spirit of Christmas. Not just this week, every week they do that, and so we want to thank them for their dedicated service. We do have two sets of flowers here. The first set of flowers is presented to us by Lalita and Kishore and Maya, and then, of course, Lalita's parents, Mr. Uncle Aruldas and Auntie Aruldas, to celebrate and for the goodness and for the mercy they have extended, that God has extended to Pradhaban Isaac as he celebrated his birthday. Yesterday was his birthday. And so Pradhaban, along with Lalita and the children and your in-laws and every one of us here, we want to wish God's richest blessings as you enter into a new year, a new page, a new chapter in your life. God has been extremely good to you, and may the Lord richly bless you as you enter and celebrate a new birthday in your life. Another set of flowers that we have is presented to us by David Raj and his wife Sujjana and their son Rintu and Premit and his wife Nikita for God blessing them with their grandson Ronik Eluri, who is celebrating his second birthday. And they're looking forward to the time when they'll be able to join the family here. He's right now he's in India along with their mother. And so David Raj and Sujjana and others, we'd like to join hands to thank God for this, for Ronik, for being a blessing to your family, and the joy that he brings. May be blessed by God in this new year. Now, we would like to thank every one of you for your sacrificial giving, as our youth pastor emphasized in his promotion. We want to thank you for your commitment, for your patience, for your dedication, and for your support. And it is because of your giving that this church has been able to make every commitment on time throughout the year 2020. Although since March, this church doors have been closed, the ministry has been going on, and you have blessed us with your giving. And I want you to know in the authority of God's word that God is going to bless you abundantly. You will never become poor by giving to the Lord. The Lord will bless you not tenfold but hundredfold. And that is assuredly that you can count on, because the Lord says to the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. So we would like to thank you for your giving. Just want to remind you that for tax purposes, whatever you want to contribute for the year 2020, it must be earmarked December 31st, 2020. So please keep that in mind. And please, because mail seems to be coming a little late, mail them a little early so that the Treasury Department can receive your mail and that can be counted towards the contribution that you're making, the sacrifice you're making for 2020. Please keep that in mind. As Mrs. Surinder pointed out, the oranges, we want to thank you for helping us. Please place your orders for the next order that is going to come at the end of January. So kindly keep that in mind. And we also would like to thank each one of you that we were able to come into your homes via Zoom for the caroling and for the contribution that you want to give towards the caroling ministry. Every penny that comes in through the caroling ministry goes towards the building fund. And so please, either you can go online and make payment and make sure you specify caroling, or you can send a check. Again, make sure that you specify as caroling. We want to thank you for your support and for your generosity and for your giving. Truly, we are blessed. Let me share God's word that was shared by Preeti Nakar, taken from Isaiah chapter 9, and I'm reading verse 6. For unto us a child is born, and to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Merciful Father in heaven, as we linger a little longer in your presence, as we open your word, and as we meditate upon it, please take control of our very being. May we shut our eyes to the world and open our hearts to you. Bless the message that has been prepared. Please breathe your spirit upon it, that it might be meet in due season. We want to thank you for your children who are able to use their talents to glorify you today. And may we always, not just today, but every minute of our life, use our time, our talents, our resources to glorify your kingdom. And now, make our worship a blessing. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Dr. James Merritt talks of the car dealership commercials that really caught his attention. And as he sat before his TV and as he was watching the commercial, this is what he read coming on the screen. Very emphatically, this person was saying, anyone can buy a car here. But if you watch very closely, there was an asterisk. And right next to this bold statement this commercial made, there were three important letters highlighted. W-A-C. You see, W stands for that your credit has been approved. In other words, what the car dealership is saying is anyone can come into a dealership store and you can buy a car, provided you meet all the qualifications, provided you go through the loan processing, the credit report processing, provided you show us that you are capable of making your monthly payment towards the car. But this morning, or rather this afternoon, I want you to know that when it comes to the Christmas story, there is no strings attached. There is no asterisk there. There is no if and when. It is all whosoever will. For I read in John chapter 3, verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, whosoever, you don't need to come up with any kind of down payment. There is no requirement. There are no conditions. There are no ifs. There are no buts. God does everything for us. You come as you are. And that is the reason why, as David was putting the program together, he came up with this title, An Amazing Grace Christmas. Yes, Christmas is usually, we think in terms of an act of love. But I want to emphasize, along with the theme that we have had throughout this morning, that it is also an act of amazing grace. And that is the uniqueness of God and becoming man on that Christmas day 2,000 years ago in the little town of Bethlehem. You see, one of the greatest gifts of Christmas is God's favor towards us who are sinful, weak, and feeble as we are. Because of his favor, which also can be termed as grace, that we are alive today, that we have the blessing that God has showered upon us. In essence, at Christmas, we receive the gift of grace and the gift of having peace with God. We are able to have peace with God because of God's grace. Otherwise, we as sinful beings can never approach a holy God, can never think of being in heaven in a holy place. It is because of grace. And that is what the Bible says. We are saved by grace. And that is the purpose. That is the emphatic message of Christmas. No wonder Apostle John, as he sat down under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, when he began to write Gospel John, he begins with a startling statement in John chapter 1, verse 1, where he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Yes, dearly beloved, this eternal God, who had no beginning, who had no origin, who has been God from eternity, who was God, who has been God, and will continue to be God in the future, decided to leave the splendor of heaven, come down and take a human form. That is the most compelling note of Christmas story. That is the most compelling note of Christ's birth. It was all motivated by grace for you and for me. Don't ever lose that important essence of Christmas. In the busyness, in the midst of whatever the little family that we're able to get together because of the pandemic, don't lose sight of this important essence or the meaning of Christmas. God's grace being manifested in God becoming man for us. And here is the truth. When God took upon humanity, Jesus Christ was able to reveal in a more visual way the very glory of God. You see, even when Moses, when he said, "Lord, I want to see you," he allowed only his glory to pass by in the clouds. Because as I pointed out, a sinful being cannot see a sinless God and still be alive. And so when Christ took upon human form, he brought in divinity and revealed to us, which was full of grace and full of truth. I want you to catch this important truth about Christmas. God designed, God orchestrated, God planned, God organized, God executed the birth of Jesus in the little town of Bethlehem 2000 years ago. It was not any role that human mind could play. Everything 100% was the role of God and the action of God. Why? Because as a result of God becoming man and living a life like us and do what he has to do for our plan of salvation, that we today, by God's grace, can have the hope of eternal life. That is amazing grace. That is an amazing grace, Christmas. Follow me very carefully. John, who said in first verse of chapter 1 that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God, now he begins to expand and talk about God's grace. And what does he say in 14th verse? If you look in very carefully, the Word of God reads, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among men, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten Son, full of grace and full of truth." Yes, this God who has been in the beginning, who had no origin, as I pointed out, who had no starting point, who is the Alpha and the Omega, who is all in all, the great I Am, the great Jehovah, the great Yahweh, he is full of truth and full of grace. That was exhibited in his birth. Furthermore, the same author, John chapter 3, we have the famous verse which I already quoted in my beginning part of my presentation in my sermon with you. John chapter 3 verse 16. There you again see grace of God being revealed and the purpose of God's grace. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life." But he doesn't stop there. May I emphasize the next verse, verse 17. "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Do you catch a glimpse of God's grace in this verse? That is the purpose of Christmas, dearly beloved. He says God was not sent into this world to take human form, to suffer for us, so that he can condemn the world, so that he can banish us, so he can punish us. No, that is not what I read in this verse. He says that the world through him might be saved. And that includes you and you and you, even the ones who are within the four walls of this sanctuary and the ones who are watching different parts of the world. That includes you. Jesus died just for you. I want you to have that assurance during the time of this pandemic. This year has been a very troubling year, a very challenging year, when thousands of people have died, thousands have been confined to the hospital bed, and many have lost their jobs. As you go through this, may this assurance of Christmas give you hope, give you joy, give you peace. In fact, there is no other assurance or reassurance that you can have to know that you are under the grace of God, that God's grace and his hand is upon you at all times. Because that is the God that I read in the Bible. He is gracious, merciful, long-suffering, forgiving. That's the God that we have in the Bible. And that is the reason he took upon human form. And that is the reason why he was born as a little baby in a manger. God becoming man, dearly beloved, is not and showing grace to us is not because you're worthy of it. It's not because you earned it. It's not because of what you have done, but because what God chose to do 2,000 years ago in the little town of Bethlehem in Judea. That is the purpose. Let me go a little further. Grace is God's love and mercy that God wanted to shower upon us because he desires us to have it. Not that we asked of, in fact, the Bible says, while we were at sinners, you read it in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that God, that Christ died for us. Even before we could go and approach him and say, Lord, I've sinned, you need to save me. Even in the Garden of Eden, the very first question that we find in Genesis chapter 3, verse 9, is that God comes in search of Adam and Eve. When they sin, instead of they're running to God, they hide themselves in the bush, and God comes in search. That is an act of grace. When Christ took upon humanity, that is an act of grace. Not because we deserve it, not because we are worthy of it, but because God is such a gracious God that he wanted not to be lost, that we should not be lost, but be saved in his kingdom. Follow me very carefully. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would not have been a perfect life of Jesus as an example for us. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would have not have been a death of atoning sacrifice on the cross. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would not have been no resurrection. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would not have been an ascension of Jesus Christ back to heaven. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would not have been the role of an intercessory role that he is playing for us in the Holy of Holies, interceding on our behalf. It would not have taken place if not for the birth of Jesus. And here is the crux of the matter. If not for the birth of Jesus, there would not have been a second coming. And so everything revolves around this important event that took place 2,000 years ago in the little town of Bethlehem. That is the amazing Christmas story. That is the amazing story of God's love towards you and me. When author puts it this way, and it really caught my attention as I was preparing this message, he said, Jesus was born in a manger, is the one who owned the ground upon which the manger laid. Jesus, as a little baby, who had no power, was the one who is the Almighty God, who brought the world into existence. He spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. He stood there and said, let there be light, and there was light. Let there be firmament, and there was firmament. Let there be sun, moon, and stars, there was sun, moon, and stars. Let there be plants and trees, there were plants and trees. God stood back and commanded, and things that were nowhere came into existence. He brought things out of nothing, dearly beloved, and that is the uniqueness of God's divine power. But on that day, the author says, as a little baby, he had no power, but he was God from eternity. That day, the day that Jesus was born, he says that he did not have not only no power on earth, but he didn't have any knowledge, because you're still a little baby. But he says he knew the end from the beginning because he's the omniscience God. What a mixture, a unity, a combination of divinity and humanity. God's love and God's grace. God's birth and grace coming together. Let me remind you, the birth of Christmas, of Jesus, the Christmas story and God's grace are intertwined. They're inseparable. You cannot separate grace from the birth of Jesus. He was born to save. and he wanted to save because God's grace towards you and me. I love the way Apostle Paul puts it in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15. He says, thanks be to God for this unspeakable gift. That must be a response to the story of Christmas. That must be a response to the amazing grace of God. That we must be rejoicing and say, glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth and goodwill towards men. That is what the angels heralded to the people there 2,000 years ago. They said, glory to God in the highest. For what? Because God becoming man, an act of amazing grace, an act of marvelous grace. And so they cried out and they said it loud. Glory to God in the highest. We see that in Luke chapter 2, verse 14. And peace on earth and goodwill toward man. And so as the Rajaratnam's family begin to sing this beautiful song, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. My chains are gone, and I'm now set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. God offers you that grace right now, dearly beloved. What a way for us to say goodbye to this painful year 2020. In spite of what would have happened to us as individuals, as families, as a church, and as a nation, as a world, the assurance that Christmas comes to you right now, an act of God's grace, an act of God's amazing grace. Accept it, embrace it, rejoice in it, because I can assure you, when you stop looking horizontally and begin to look vertically towards God, you're going to see that amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Amazing grace. Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my chains are gone. I've shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Merciful Father in heaven, we want to thank you for that amazing grace. Yes, Lord, our God and our Savior have ransomed us. And like a flood, your mercy rains upon us. Unending love, amazing grace. And so, Lord, thank you. Thank you for showing that love. And now, it's my humble request to you, people in different parts of the world who have been tuning into this ministry here this morning, whatever the challenge that they may be going through, whatever the sickness they're confronting, whatever the financial difficulties they might be facing, whatever the relationship problem that they may have, in the midst of chaos and confusion, in the midst of doom and darkness, may we fix our eyes upon you and find strength, find grace to take us through. And if you are weak, even to walk, please may your hand carry us through. For you are an amazing grace, God. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
And then,
Thank you for choosing to worship with us today at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church. We hope that you are truly blessed through the music, the song, through the prayer, through the sermon. We pray that you'll take each of those messages to heart. And as Pastor had mentioned to us today, remember the grace that we received on Christmas Day when Jesus was born. It was not because we deserved it. It's not because we asked for it, but simply because of his own goodness and his grace that he wanted each of his children to be saved. And you have that choice. May you remember the grace of God that was given to us when Jesus was born on this earth, lived and dwelt among us in order to save us. We thank you for each of you that joined us from around the world. We have Ponzi, Stacey Ann Martin, Barbara from California, Frida from Kenya, Albert from Nairobi, Claire, Clifton, Sampath, Morris from Pune, Pradeep from Bangalore, Ronnie, Grace, Joseph Surly, Amber, Esther Singh, Chiquita, Jennifer, Jay Devadas from Redding, California. All of you, we thank you so much for worshiping with us from around the world. You truly are the reason we are able to bring these messages of hope, of truth, and grace to many people around the world. We thank you for all of your prayers through this year. 2020 has been a different one for all of us, and especially here at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church, as we've been trying to do more and more through our media ministry. We thank you for those contributions that you've made financially to help our media ministry, and we continue to ask for that. As we go through another uncertain year, as we want to be able to bring more messages of hope and encouragement to many around the world, we ask for your, humbly request your financial contributions for the media ministry, that we'll be able to continue to bring to your home, into the comforts of your home, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news, the truth of the Seventh-day Adventist message, the three angels' message to be broadcast around the world. And that can only be done through your funds that you provide sacrificially and generously to this church. So we thank you for that. And if you'd like to provide such a financial contribution, you can visit our website by clicking on the tab for giving, or you can send a check to the mailing address that is also on our website here for Burtonsville, Maryland. Once again, thank you so much. We pray that you'll remember that God loves you and that it is through his grace that you are saved. We thank you so much for being a part of this church family. Join us at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our prayer and praise service. Sing some songs with us. Tell a friend. Submit your prayer request that we can pray live online for you. We look forward to seeing you once again. Have a blessed Sabbath, and we will see you soon.